Good afternoon, students. In previous class, we are discussing about the what are the special features of traction motors. Okay, so and what are which types of motors are used in traction purpose? Okay, so now in this class, we are discussing about the braking. Okay, how you can apply the braking to the traction motors and what are first of all what is braking and what are the different types of braking? Okay, so and that the different types of brakings are applied to the different. How it will be applied now all are discussed in this class. See, braking. Okay, so first of all, braking. Braking is nothing but see, if any time it is required to stop an electric motor. So at any time we have to stop the electric motor, then the electric supply must be disconnected from its terminals to bring the motor to rest. Okay, so whenever we want to stop the electrical motor, at that time we have to must disconnect the from its electrical supply. So that's why. See, to bring the motor to the rest. So in this method, even though supply is cut off, the motor is continue to rotate for long time due to inertia. So whenever you have to cut the supply, but due to inertia, so whenever you can switch off the terminals, so at that time also the motor will be continue to rotate because of its inertia. In some cases, there is a delay in bringing to other equipment. Okay, so but some cases it may be delayed. Okay, so that's why. So that it is necessary to bring the motor rest quickly. Okay, so to avoid these all problems, you are must and should set the electrical motor to the rest position quickly. Okay, the process of bringing the motor to rest within the predetermined time is known as braking. Okay, so braking is nothing but the process of the bringing the motor to the rest within the predetermined time is known as braking. Okay. So a good braking system must having following features. Okay, when you have to say that system will be good braking system is whenever the system having these all following features. See, first one, braking should be fast and reliable. Okay, the braking which is applied it should be fast and reliable. The equipment to stop the motor should be in such a way that the kinetic energy of the rotating parts of the motor should be dissipated as soon as the brakes are applied. Okay, so whenever we have to apply the braking. So at that time, okay, so the electric motor should be dissipated its kinetic energy. So whenever it dissipates its total kinetic energy, at that time there will be no rotational energy. So at that time the motor will be stopped. Okay. So next one is what? Braking applied to bring the motor to rest position is of two types. So here braking is also again two types. What are those? Electric braking and mechanical braking. See, first of all, electric braking. So electric braking is nothing but in this process the kinetic energy of the rotating parts of the motor is converted into the electrical energy. Okay, in this process of braking, the kinetic energy, okay, so the kinetic energy of the rotating parts is converted into the electrical energy, which in turn dissipated as heat energy in a resistance, or in sometimes the electrical energy is returned to the supply. So electric braking is nothing but here the kinetic energy of the rotating parts of the motor is converted into electrical energy. Okay, so at that time which is dissipated as a heat energy in a resistance. Okay, but in some cases it will be again given to the supply. Here no energy is dissipated in brake shoes, so but some no energy will be lost in the brake shoes. So next one is what? Mechanical braking. Okay, so mechanical braking is nothing but in this process of braking, the kinetic energy of the rotating parts is dissipated in the form of heat. Okay, so the kinetic energy of the rotating parts is directly dissipated as the heat. But here, in electrical braking, the kinetic energy of the rotating parts of the motor is first converted into the electrical energy. But here, in the mechanical braking, in the process of braking, the kinetic energy of the rotating parts is dissipated in the form of heat by the brake shoes of the brake lining that rubs on a wheel of vehicle or brake drum. Okay, the total mechanical energy will be lining the and rubs the wheel of the vehicle. So coming to the advantages of electrical braking over the mechanical braking. So in our electrical traction purpose, OU total uses the electrical braking. So why you are using electrical braking over the mechanical braking means these are some of the advantages over the mechanical braking. Okay, now you have to see the what are the advantages of that electrical braking over the mechanical braking. So first one is the electric braking is smooth, fast and reliable. Okay, so the electric braking operation is a smooth, fast and reliable. Higher speeds can be maintained. Okay, by using the electrical braking, you have to maintain the high speed. This is because the electric braking is quite fast. So whenever braking speed is high, okay, so at that time the braking will be done fast. This leads to the higher capacity of the system. Okay, whenever the electric braking is quite fast, so at that time this leads to the higher capacity of the system. The electric braking is more economical. Okay, and it is in economic point of view. So the electric braking is also more economical. This is due to excessive wear on brake blacks or brake lining that result frequent and costly replacement in mechanical braking. But this is due to excessive wear on the brake black, okay, brake lining that result frequent and cost replacement in mechanical braking. But in mechanical braking, it damages the brake shoe. So that's why every time you have to replace. So that's why so compared to this point of view, the electric braking is more economical. Similarly, heat produced in the electric braking is less. Okay, here the heat, the what amount of the heat produced is less and not harmful, but heat produced in the mechanical braking will cause the failure of brakes. So whenever electric braking is nothing but in electrical braking, the kinetic energy will be converted into the electrical energy, and then that electrical energy is dissipated as heat. So whenever it is dissipated as heat, so in electrical braking it is dissipate less heat, okay, and it will also not harmful to the brakes. But here in mechanical braking, the kinetic energy is directly converted into the heat. So whenever it is directly converted into the heat, so at that time the heat produced in the mechanical braking will cause the failure of the brakes. Okay. So in the electric braking, sometime it is possible to feed back electrical energy during braking period to the supply system. So in electrical braking, in some cases, maybe that energy what is getting that electrical energy is again fed back to the supply. This results in saving the operating cost. Okay, so whenever we have to supply the electrical energy, again fed back to the supply, so at that time there will be saving in the operating cost. This is not possible in the case of mechanical braking. Okay, so but this is not possible in the mechanical braking. Okay, these are the advantages of electric braking over the mechanical braking. Okay, coming to the disadvantages. Okay, when you are coming to the disadvantages, okay, what are the disadvantages? So in addition to the above advantages, the electric braking suffers from the following disadvantages. Okay, so the electrical braking having the advantages, but it having also some disadvantages. Coming to the disadvantages, what is the first one? During braking period, so whenever you have to apply the brake, so that means that the motor will be stopped in that period. The traction motor act as generator, and electric brakes can almost stop the motor, but it cannot hold stationary. So at that time, the traction motor will act as generator. So at that time, the electrical motor stop the motor, but it cannot hold stationary. Okay, that means you can keep that brakes will be not constant. Okay, hence it is necessary to employ the mechanical braking in addition to the electric braking. Again, to stop that motor, you have externally applying the mechanical braking to the electric braking. Okay, so next one is what? Traction motor has to work as a generator during the braking period. So that motor has to select in such a way that it should have suitable braking characteristics. Okay, so whenever the traction motor will be act as a generator, okay, during braking period. Okay, so that's why you have to select the suitable, you have to select the motor having the suitable braking characteristics. Okay, so next one is what? The initial cost of the electric braking equipment is also costlier. Okay, and as well as the initial cost. Okay, the initial cost of the electric braking equipment is also costlier. Okay, so these are the disadvantages of the electric braking. Okay, so next you have to see the types of electric braking. Okay, so what are the types of electric braking can be applied to the traction motor vehicle by any of the following methods, namely plugging, rheostatic braking, regenerative braking. Okay, So these all are, I think you are all reading the PhD subject, okay, power semiconductor drives, okay. So what are the types of electric braking? Plugging, rheostatic braking and regenerative braking, okay. Coming to first, plugging. So in this method of braking, the electric motor is reconnected to the supply in such a way that it has no developed torque in opposite direction to the movement of rotor. So in this method, okay, in this method of braking, the electric motor, okay, here the motor is reconnected to the supply. Okay, so that means it is again connected to the supply in such a way that it has to develop a torque. So at that time, it develops the torque in the opposite direction to the movement of the rotor. Okay, whenever the, if suppose the motor will be rotated in clockwise direction, the motor rotor, so at that time it will be produces a torque in the anti-clockwise direction. Okay. Okay, so now the motor will re-accelerate until zero speed is zero and then accelerate in opposite direction. So at that time the motor will be de-accelerate. That means the speed will be decreases until zero. So and again it will be accelerates in opposite direction immediately. That means automatically. Okay, automatically it will be accelerates in opposite direction. Immediately it is necessary to disconnect the motor from the supply system as soon as come to rest. So at that time, whenever again the motor will be automatically rotated means, so at that time again the motor will be moving starting. So at that time it is necessary to disconnect the motor from the supply system to come to the rest. Okay, so and what is the main disadvantages of this method is that kinetic energy of the rotating parts of the motor is wasted. Okay, so here the kinetic energy of the rotating parts will be wasted and an additional amount of energy from the supply is required to develop the torque in reverse direction. So here I will say that here the torque will be developed in opposite direction. Okay, to overcome that torque, that means you have to develop the reverse direction torque. So at that time you have to need the some amount of extra energy. In this method, the motor should be connected to the supply during braking. Okay, during braking period, here the motor is connected to the supply. This method can be applied to both DC and AC motors. Okay, so the plugging is applied to the both DC and AC motors. See, first you have to see first, plugging. So here I am says that plugging is applied to both DC motors and AC motors. First, we have to see how you can apply the plugging to the DC motors. Okay, so see, plugging is nothing but reverse current braking. Okay, so plugging is also called as reverse current braking. This method of braking can be applied to both DC shunt and DC series motor by reversing either current through the armature or field winding in order to produce the torque in opposite direction. Okay, so that means this method, okay, this method of braking is applied to both DC shunt motors and as well as DC series motor. So why you have to apply to DC shunt motor and DC series motor means by reversing. So whenever you have to reversing the current to the armature or field winding in order to produce the torque in opposite direction. Okay, but not both. Okay, so that means you cannot reverse the both windings. So at a time either you have to reverse in the field winding or either in armature winding. The connection diagrams for the both DC shunt and DC normal and braking period are given below. Okay, so see here you have to see during normal running period. Okay, so whenever the so this is which motor? DC shunt motor. So whenever the DC shunt motor will be moving, so at that time now in normal running speed, so this is field winding. So actual diagram, actual how you can draw the DC shunt motor is this one. So whenever you have to apply the braking, see at that time, say the, so here you have reversed the field winding direction. Okay, so see here the direction will be reversed. Here you have to change the field winding direction. Okay, so that is the difference. Okay, see that means to produce the opposite torque. See here you can see the DC series motor. Whenever you have to DC series motor, here also. So this is normal DC series motor connection. Here you have to connect the field winding is in series with armature. So whenever you have to apply the braking during braking period, see the field winding direction will be changes. Okay, you can reverse the field winding. Okay, that is the process involved in the plugging. Okay, See here, the connection diagrams for the normal running conditions of both DC shunt and DC motors are shown figure. Okay, the back EMF developed by the motor is equal in magnitude and same as the direction of terminal or supply voltage. Okay, so at that time the EMF, EMF developed is same as the normal condition. Okay, so during the braking, the armatures of both shunt and series motors are reversed. Okay, so here at that time you can change the field winding direction. So at that time the armature winding directions will be also reversed. Okay, so now the back EMF developed by the motor as direction of terminal voltage. See, at that time here the back EMF, the back EMF developed in the direction of the terminal voltage. That means in the direction of the supply voltage. Okay, so a high resistance R is connected in series with the armature to limit the high starting current during braking period. So why you are connecting? So whenever you have to apply the braking, so initially in braking period at that time high starting current will be produced. Okay, to limit that high starting current, here you have to connect the high resistance in series with the armature. Okay, so this is braking is applied to the DC series motor and DC shunt motor. See here, we have to see current flowing through the armature during normal running condition in motor. Okay, so what is the formula? I1 equal to V minus EB by RA. That means V means terminal voltage, supply voltage. EB means back EMF developed. RA means armature resistance. Okay, see, VB is back EMF and RA is the armature resistance. Current flowing through the armature during braking period. So whenever you have to apply the braking, so at that time here the EMF will be produced in opposite direction. So at that time here you can add the extra high series resistance. Okay, at that time the current I2 will becomes IE2 equal to V minus of minus EB by RA plus R. Okay, so at that time this formula will becomes V plus EB by RA plus R, you can assume the R dash. Okay, so electric braking torque TB is directly proportional to phi I2. Okay, so that means you can know in DC series motor always the torque is proportional to the product of the flux and current. Okay, so at that time TB is directly proportional to phi I2. So at that time here you can write, you can remove this proportionality constant. So at that time here you can write TB equal to K1 phi I2. So I2 formula is already you can get the I2 value is V plus EB by R dash. Now here you can substitute in this formula. So in the place of I2, so at that time this formula will become K1 phi into V plus EB by R dash. So at that time you can multiplying with the K1 phi will be multiplying with this term and you have to split. Okay, so at that time it will be becomes K1 phi V divided by R dash plus K1 phi EB by R dash. But we know that EB is proportional to N phi. Okay, that means speed and flux. Okay, so at that time, so here in the place of EB, here you can write N phi. So at that time N phi you can write phi into phi will become phi square. Okay, so at that time K1 phi, K1, K2, phi square and R dash by R dash. Okay, so here K1, K2 constant will be assumed as another constant K3. Okay, so at that time here you can get, K1 phi V by R dash plus K3 phi square N by R dash. So here you can assume K4. K4 is nothing but K1 V R dash is a constant, total constant you can assume K4. So plus, here this is plus, plus K5. K5 means you can assume K3 N by R dash. So at that time you can, the equation will become, the braking torque is equal to so K4 phi plus K5 phi square. So again here phi is directly proportional to the IA. So at that time this again this constant will be changes K6 IA plus K7 IA square. That means in case of series motor, flux developed by the field winding is depending upon the current flowing through it. Okay, but in case of shunt motor, flux remains constant. Okay, so this is the formula for DC series motor. Okay, the torque developed, that means braking torque, that means the braking applied for the DC series motor. But in shunt motor, the flux remains constant. So that means the flux remains constant means at that time current is also constant. So at that time here you can remove the current values. At that time the formula will becomes TB equal to K9N. Okay, N means speed. Okay, so that means here the current will be depending upon the speed. Okay, so this is the formula for DC shunt motor. Okay. See, in case of series, there is a flowing through it, shunt motor, the flux remains constant. So, okay, you can write this by this formula. Okay. So this is the plugging applied to the DC motors. So now you have to see the how you can apply the plugging to the induction motor. Okay, so plugging to induction motor. So next you have to see how you can apply the plugging to the synchronous motor. Okay, so first one is plugging applied to the induction motor. During normal operating condition, the rotating magnetic field of the stator and rotation of the rotor are in the same direction. So whenever you cannot apply the braking, and so at that time in normal condition, okay, so normal operating condition, the rotating magnetic field, okay, so the magnetic field developed by the stator and the rotation of the rotor are in the same direction. But during the braking period, okay, so the plugging applied to the induction motor reversing the two phases of the three phases of stator winding. Okay, so here we having the three phases. Okay, three phase AC supply. So whenever you have to give three phase AC supply, okay. So so at that time whenever you have to apply the braking, so at that time it will be reversing the any two phases of the three phases in stator winding to change the direction of the rotating magnetic field. Okay. So that rotating magnetic field and the rotor will be rotating in opposite direction. So at that time the magnetic field and rotor will be rotating in opposite direction, so that relative speed between EMF and rotor is nearly twice the synchronous speed. Okay, at that time the speed will be greater than the, that means twice the synchronous speed. Okay, so at that time that will becomes ns minus half minus ns is equal to 2 ns. Okay, see here, during normal condition, see RYB, R dash Y dash B dash RYB, stator rotor, okay, but in this same direction, but whenever we have to apply the braking, so at that time see here the phases, here I am says that any two phases will be changes. See here you can interchange the B and Y phases. Okay, so at that time slip during the braking period is given by S equal to minus ns minus ns by ns. That means will becomes minus 2 ns by ns equal to minus 2. Okay, but the voltage induced in the rotor E2. Okay, so in induction motor the E2 is proportional to the slip and stator voltage. Okay, all of you well know about this formula. Okay, this formula we get in induction motors in electrical machines 3 subject. So at that time E2 is directly proportional to the slip into stator voltage. Okay, so that rotor voltage during the braking period is twice the normal voltage. So at that time the voltage will be getting, okay, the rotor voltage during the braking period will get it twice the normal voltage. Okay, to avoid the damage of rotor winding, okay, it should be provided with additional insulation. Okay, it should be provided with additional insulation. Okay, so at that time the voltage will be also increases twice. Okay, so whenever the voltage will be occurs, it may be damage the rotor winding. So it should be provided with additional insulation. So at that time you can provide the additional insulation to withstand high induced voltage. Okay, to withstand with high induced voltage, okay, here you can apply the additional insulation. The rotation of magnetic field in the reverse direction produce the torque in reverse direction. The rotation of the magnetic field in the reverse direction, and also it produce the torque in reverse direction, thereby applying the brakes to the motor. So at that time whenever the torque will be produced in the reverse direction, at that time the brakes will be applying to the motor. The braking of the induction motor can be analyzed by the torque slip characteristics. Okay, so the braking in induction motors can be analyzed by the torque slip characteristics. See, these are the torque slip characteristics of the induction motor. So here you can take the torque on y axis and slip in. So here you can take the slip in percentage. Okay, slip in percentage on y axis, here torque in newton meters. So here first, whenever the slip increases, torque will be also increases during running period. So whenever you have to apply, so again the torque will be decreases. So whenever you have to take the braking, so the torque will be less in braking. Okay, so with additional, why? Because without a additional resistance, but here you can add the additional resistance to withstand the high currents. So at that time this is the torque slip characteristics of the induction motor. Okay, see I2B. Okay, so the current, rotor current during the braking period is given by SE2 by square root of R2 square plus SX square whole square. Okay, see, this is the graph between the slip and rotor current or rotor voltage. Okay, so this is during running period and this will be whenever you have to apply in the braking period. Okay, so whenever slip will be increases, the rotor current and rotor voltage will goes to highest value in the braking period. So this up to now we have to discuss how you can apply the plugging to the induction motor. Now we have to see the plugging applied to the synchronous motor. Okay, how you can apply the plugging to the synchronous motor. Okay, so see. Normally, the stator winding of the synchronous motor is fed with three-phase AC supply to produce the rotating magnetic field. Okay, so generally the synchronous motor means that is nothing but AC motor. So that means the synchronous motor is also three-phase motor. So that's why here you have to give a three-phase AC supply to produce the rotating magnetic field. Okay, that induces stator poles. Okay, and the field winding is excited by giving the DC supply, thereby inducing the rotor poles. Okay, so whenever field winding is excited by the DC supply, so at that time they inducing in the rotor poles. At any instant, the stator poles get locked with the rotor poles, and the synchronous motor is rotating with synchronous speed. Okay, so this synchronous motor will be acting on the principle of magnetic locking. Okay, so that means the stator poles will be gets locked by the rotor poles in the synchronous motor, rotating at the synchronous speed. Okay, so in this method of plugging applied to the synchronous motor, simply it is not possible to produce the counter torque during braking period. Okay, by interchanging the any of the three phases. Okay, any of two of out of three phases. So what are you doing in induction motor? In induction motor, you have to interchange the two phases, but that application will not possible in the synchronous motor. This is due to the magnetic locking. That means the stator poles and rotor poles will be locking magnetically. See here. Here synchronous speed RYB, so two poles. Okay, these poles are locking magnetically. Okay, that means these two are attracted, these two are attracted. Okay, these are coupled magnetically. So that's why you have to, it is not possible to interchange. Okay, so that means, so, but how you can develop the torque? So must and should you have to develop the torque. Okay, to apply the braking. So that's why, see, in order to develop the counter torque, should be provided with damper winding. So to provide the counter torque, that means the opposite torque, the rotor of the synchronous motor should be provided with damper winding. Okay, so the EMF induced in the damper winding whenever there is any change, that is the reversal of direction of the stator field. Okay, so whenever you have to change any direction of the stator field, at that time the EMF induced in the damper windings also will be changes. Okay, so now according to Lenz law. So what is the Lenz law? It opposes the cause to produce it. Okay, so that means it opposes the, so whatever the cause to produce the EMF, okay, by using a Lenz law, it will be opposes. Okay, so now according to Lenz law, the EMF induced in the damper winding opposes the change which producing it. Okay, so this EMF induced in the damper winding produces the circulating current to produce the torque in reverse direction. So that means it opposes its direction. Okay, so whenever it opposes its direction, so that means it produces the torque in the opposite direction, reverse direction. Okay, so that torque is nothing but the braking torque. Okay, so this torque is known as braking torque. This braking torque helps to bring the motor to rest. Okay, so now here to apply this torque and bring the motor to the rest position. Okay, rheostat or dynamic braking, in this method of braking, the electric motor is disconnected from the supply during the braking period. Okay, so whenever you have to apply in the rheostatic and dynamic braking to the synchronous motor, so at that time directly you can disconnect the electrical motor from the supply and reconnect the same electrical resistance. So after that, again you have to reconnect it with the same electrical resistance, but the field winding is continuously excited from the supply in the same direction. Whenever the motor will be disconnected, but the field winding will be continuously excited from the supply in the same direction. Thus, during the starts work as generator during the braking period. Okay, so that's why the field winding is excited. Okay, that's why during the braking period also, the motor will be working as the generator, and all the kinetic energy of the rotating parts will be converted into the electrical energy. So what is the purpose of the generator? It converts the mechanical energy into electrical energy. So whenever it starts working as the generator during braking period, so at the time the kinetic energy of the all rotating parts will be converted into the electrical energy and is dissipated across the external resistance. So what are the resistance externally you have to connected? That is load. So at that time, the total energy will be dissipated across the external resistance. Okay, one of the main advantages of the rheostatic braking is electrical energy is not drawn by the motor during braking period compared to plugging. So coming to the see here, this from here this is rheostatic braking. Okay, so whenever you have to apply the rheostatic braking, okay, so the electrical energy is dissipated across the external resistance. One of the main advantages of the rheostatic braking is electrical energy is not drawn by the motor during braking period compared to the plugging. The rheostatic braking. So this rheostatic braking is also applied to both DC motors and as well as the AC motors. See, first here you have to see the rheostatic braking is applied to the So first here you have to see how you can apply the rheostatic braking to the DC motors. Okay, see, the rheostatic braking can be applied to both DC shunt motors and DC series motor. Okay, so here the rheostatic braking is applied both DC shunt motors and DC series motors by disconnecting the armature from the supply. So that means directly you have to disconnect the armature from the supply and reconnecting it across and external resistance. Okay, and it will be reconnected across and external resistance. This is required to dissipate the kinetic energy of the all rotating parts, thereby bringing the motor to rest. So at that time it will be dissipate the kinetic energy of all rotating parts, okay, thereby bringing the motor to rest position. Okay, so first how you can apply to the DC shunt motor, here you have to see. So see, this is normal DC shunt motor winding during normal running condition. As usual, the field winding is connected parallel to the armature winding. Whenever you have to apply braking, okay, so during braking period, see here, the armature winding and field winding both are reversed. See, in case of both armature are connected across the DC supply. So at that time, here you can connect these two are to the DC supply. Okay, so this is the rheostatic braking. Okay, so during braking period, the armature is disconnected from the supply. Okay, directly during the braking period, the armature is disconnected from the supply and field winding is continuously excited by the supply in the same direction. The kinetic energy of the all rotating parts is dissipated in the resistance R. So here we have to connect the extra one resistor R. So at that time, the total energy, that total kinetic energy will be dissipated in that resistor. Okay, so now that machine will be working as a generator. Okay, so at that time the machine will start working as generator. Now braking is developed proportional to the product of the field and armature currents. So at that time, okay, so what is the braking will be developed in the DC shunt motor is proportional to the product of the field and armature currents. Okay, but the shunt motor flux will be remains constant. Okay, the shunt motor flux will be remains constant, so that braking torque is proportional to the armature current at lower speeds. Braking torque is less in order to maintain the constant braking. Okay, so but here the field flux is constant. Okay, so that why the braking torque is proportional to the armature current at only low speeds. Okay, so in this method the braking torque is less. Okay, and in order to maintain the constant braking torque. Okay, so the armature is gradually disconnected. Hence the armature current remains same, thereby maintaining the uniform braking torque. So whenever you have to disconnect the armature, so at that time also the armature current remains same, okay, by maintaining the uniform braking torque. Okay, that is the how you can apply the braking to the DC shunt motor. Okay, so now you have to see how you can apply the rheostatic braking to the DC series motor. Okay, in this braking which is applied to the DC series motor, the armature is disconnected from the supply and is reconnected across the external resistance R. So here also same, in this method also you have to So this can be armature, and you have to connected across the resistance R. But simply it is not possible to develop the retarding torque by the DC series motor after connecting the armature across the resistance as DC shunt motor. Okay, but here you have to producing the torque is not simple compared to the DC shunt motor. Whenever you have to disconnect the armature, that means whenever you after connecting the armature. So see, this is the normal during normal running period DC series motor. So here the field winding is connected in series with the armature. During the braking period, here you have to disconnect the armature from the supply. Okay, so and again it is connected across the resistance, high resistance R. Okay, so see, in case of DC series motor, both the field and armature windings are connected across the resistance after disconnecting the same from the supply. Okay, whenever you have to field wind across the disconnecting the supply, so here you have to disconnect the from the supply and connected across the resistance R. Okay, so current directions of both field winding and armature winding will be reversed. So at that time the current will flow whenever you have to disconnect from the supply. So at that time the current will flow from the armature winding and field winding will be both are reversed. Okay, so this results in the production of torque in the same direction as before. So that's why this will be produced in this side. So in order to produce the braking torque, only the direction of the current in the armature is to be reversed. Okay, so the connection diagram of the, if more than one motor has to be used in electric traction, all the motors can be connected in equalizer connection. In this connection, one machine is excited by the armature of the another machine. So if suppose you have to use the more number of motors, so this is the arrangement. Okay, that means here you have to connect the equalizer connection to produce the, so this is normal. Whenever normal running condition, this is whenever braking condition, this is the, see here this this armature is excited by the another field winding resistance. This is excited by the another, you see, third motor field winding resistance like this. That means the armature is excited by the another field winding. So that means not same motor. That is nothing but the equalizer connection. Okay. See, now you have to apply the braking torque in DC motors. Okay, how you can get the braking torque in DC motors means, see, the current flowing through the armature during braking period. Okay, during braking period, the current flows through the armature is given by Ia equal to Eb by R plus Ra. Okay, so this is the formula to get the armature current. Okay, so armature current, so that means extra here you have to connect the resistance. So generally Eb by Ra, back EMF by armature resistance. But here you can get Eb by R plus Ra. So where Eb is the back EMF developed, okay? And R is the external resistance and Ra is the armature resistance. So and you know that back EMF, okay? Back EMF Eb is always proportional to phi n, okay? So flux into speed. So at that time here you can take the proportionality constant. Here you can write here one constant proportional. You can remove the proportional. Here you can write constant Eb equal to K1 phi n. So at the time the braking current. So here you can apply in place of Eb K1 phi n. So at the time Ia will becomes K1 phi n divided by R plus Ra. So braking torque. So braking torque Tb is proportional to phi into Ia. Okay. So the braking torque is proportional to the phi into Ia. So that means torque is always proportional to the product of the flux into armature current. So at that time Tb equal to, here you can write K2, another constant, phi into Ia. So now substitute this now here in place of Ia, here you can substitute K1 phi n by R plus Ra. So this equation is 9.8 and this equation is 9.9. See here, now substitute equation 9.8 in equation 9.8. So for shunt motors, flux is always constant. Okay, so directly here you can write. So at that time you can get the braking torque. So but flux is remains constant in which, so whenever here you have to apply, so at that time it will becomes K1 K2 phi square n by R plus Ra. So K1 K2 you can assume K3 phi square n divided by R plus Ra. So in place of shunt motors only you can get Tb equal to K K3 n divided by r plus ra. Why? Because for shunt motors, the flux is always constant. Okay, so now in this class we are discussing the how you can apply the rheostatic braking in the DC shunt motor. In next class you have to discussing how you can apply the rheostatic braking to the DC series motor.